Oh my God, my hands look so big in the frame. Oh, Joe Biden made that video and he put his hands in the front, like monster hands. Oh my God. Okay.
Hi, my name is Alex Morris and I'm a senior writer at Rolling Stone. Today I talked with late night comedian extraordinaire Samantha Bee, and we discussed making a TV show in the woods with your whole family involved and how to make your own toilet paper if you run out. Oh, it's good to see you.
It's really good to see you. I'm looking at all the stuff you have in your background. I really like it.
Oh,
I like it. I like seeing how people live. It's nice.
I know. This little glimpse into those secret lives.
I know.
How the hell are you doing? How's your family? Is everyone healthy? Is everyone good?
Everyone is healthy. Everyone is good. And we've actually been socially isolating for a really long time. So we are
10 years.
So 10 to 20 years. We've been practicing for this a long time. Yeah, we're all isolated. We have been for weeks and weeks, and somehow we're not going crazy with each other. We're sort of, it's an interesting time.
So you have left New York, the craziness of New York City.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And you are now making your show in the woods.
Yes, in the forest. I have a little patch of land behind our house with a forest on it, and we are making the show from there. It looks like the Blair Witch Project. There's a lot of dead trees. There's a lot of, like, there's no leaves yet on the trees. We just had one of the trees started to flower yesterday, which was very nice. But that's an anomaly.
So what are the mechanics of that? How do you make a TV show in the Blair Witch Project woods behind your house?
Well, like 25 years ago, you meet a partner in life who makes television. and then for a couple of years, my husband and I we've been married for almost 20 years and we've been together for like 24 years or something like that. And since the very beginning of our relationship, we've been making projects together. So we've made movies in the first house we ever owned. We made two big movies, big for us, but two low budget movies. So we are A, very used to collaborating, and B, very used to working on a kind of a shoestring setup with very little equipment and kind of making the most of it. He's got a great eye. He's a television director. He just really knows how to do this. We have a little bit of equipment of our own, and our show started to shut down basically. Sorry, I'm totally monologuing. Is that okay?
I love it.
Okay.
I love all your monologues.
Oh, God.
Appointment TV, come on.
Okay, I'm right again. When we were shooting our last show in the studio, which was March 11th, I think it was the 11th, they started to shut our building down around us, and we were actually taping when they learned that someone in the building had tested positive for coronavirus. So they were evacuating floors of the studio building that we were in, and eventually they evacuated everybody. We were the last people there, and we just really kind of didn't know what was happening. And then they locked us into the building, and they were when we finished taping, they were like, get out. So the mission that we executed in that moment was everybody go home and grab whatever equipment you need. We don't know what's going to happen. We're definitely not going to be in this studio again for the foreseeable future. Grab what you can, grab what you need to edit at home, grab what you need to do graphics at home, grab some wardrobe, grab just everything. And everybody did that. And we haven't been back in the building since. And we got a little bit of, in that interim, we got a little bit of equipment. I have a lighting, I have couple of ring lights around, and we got some C-stands so that we could battery pack a few little lights in the backyard. But essentially we're making a broadcast quality show on an iPhone. And Jason knows, he just understands lighting. It's really all about the lighting, and he really gets that. So we're harnessing the sun and trying to shoot when it's sunny, and we haven't yet had days and days of rain.
Yeah.
We had to shoot something in. We have a plan for that because we have a little rickety gazebo. I don't know. It's very weather dependent, our happiness.
But I can tell from our setups that your lighting is way better than mine, let's be honest, right now, in this moment.
I'll send you a selfie of what the actual setup is. So I have I have a proper ring light over here, which I guess if you were an Instagram influencer, you would already have like multiples of these in your home. Like, I don't know. And then my daughter has a ring light. And so I have hers and I have this big one. And my computer is sitting on top of a wicker basket on top of a stool.
Yeah.
And I put this blanket on this, I'm in the spare bedroom where my dad usually sleeps. And I put out a blanket for you so it wouldn't look as rough as it actually is.
Thank you.
Move some debris out of the way.
But it's, you know, coronavirus hospitality.
Yeah, totally.
So as you were getting evacuated from your building, yes, you were thinking, I'm going to be making a show somewhere not here.
Somewhere not here. Yes, somewhere not here. And that was just an impulse. Like, I'm not sure why we had the foresight to kind of understand that in that moment, but I'm really glad that we did.
Yeah.
It felt like, you know, you could really feel it. You could really feel everything escalating. And there was just no world in which we're going to be back there, nor do we want to be back there. Like, we had already canceled our audience for the day that day, and things were, you know, I mean, you remember, it was a very rapid, it really was a very rapid kind of descent.
Yeah.
So who knew what the show would look like? I mean, we just had no clue.
So working with your husband, mm-hmm, is it helping your coronavirus marriage dynamic or hurting it?
It's helping it. It's helping it to be task oriented because everything is so awful. It's so devastating. And just having a task every day is really, it's just giving our days kind of some shape and purpose other than homeschooling, which we are also doing because we have three kids. So that's a different mission that we are not excelling at. We're doing much better at the show part, I think.
Same. Yeah. Homeschooling. Mm-hmm. I'm glad I never contemplated it. Now I know that I was right.
I do remember that when I was growing up, a lot of people in my family were like, why would you choose a career in the arts? You should go into teaching. You need to become a teacher. And I was like, that's not my calling. I would not be good at that. And that has borne fruit. That is just a fact. And I always knew it deep, deep in my bones.
What are you learning about your family that you didn't know during this time? Or is there something you're learning?
I don't know. We've used our kids in production. So they really have an aptitude for it. They have a very natural aptitude for production, which is great. Like my eldest they're a little bit older. You know, they're old enough to hold a flex bill, to get a little bit of a light bounce. And my son has been, he's 11, and he's been kind of like documenting our process on his phone. And then yesterday he was doing a job too. He was holding, because I have a prompter on an iPad, and he was holding that and kind of like backing up as I was. So everybody's just developing some very useful skills. I'm not sure they would ever want to do this job in the future. Maybe we're really cursing them, but they're actually very good at it. My daughter's excellent at, like, the flex fill is just this little, you know, it's just a little aluminum kind of thing that you hold up under your chin to just give yourself a little. but you have to kind of like adjust it because the light changes and I move. And so to just kind of follow someone's face with that flex is a skill in itself. She's very good at it. She really understands how to work it. Good for her.
Have you had any interesting encounters with wildlife?
We have had to hold for wildlife, which is nice. We hold, there's a lot of bird action in our backyard. All the birds are really ramping up these days. There's lots of hawks screeching overhead. We have to hold for that. And then we shoot the show on Tuesdays roughly now. We're trying to do that so it can be on the air on Wednesday. And yesterday there was like a fight. There's a bird fight with between a hawk and like a big grackle. So they were just tussling. They were just like angrily doing stuff in the tree as birds do. Oh my God, my hands look so big in the frame. Joe Biden made that video and he put his hands in the first, like, monster hands. Oh my God. Okay.
Wait, so you mentioned Joe Biden. So I have to, I mean, obviously, like, the news just happened that Bernie's out of the race.
Yes.
I have to, my phone is literally exploding with this stuff.
Okay.
So what are your thoughts on that? This is like late breaking news.
Yeah, I think it's, you know, I don't know. I don't know what my staff is very upset. I think it's upsetting. It's not really what, you don't feel a lot of optimism in these moments. Maybe we should, I don't know. It's not the outcome that I was really personally hoping for, but I'll get behind whoever the nominee is. And that is just a fact. I'll get so far behind whoever the, well, now we know who the nominee is. I'm going to get so far behind him, I can't even tell you. Fine. Okay. This is the hand we are dealt. All right. Okay. All right.
Speaking of administrations, you did a pretty substantial coronavirus segment back in January, looking at cuts to the CDC,
mm-hmm.
You know, back in that innocent time of January.
Yeah.
Has anything about the way the situation has unfolded surprised you in terms of the government's response or people's response or anything?
It surprised me that Jared Kushner got involved. I wonder where the bottom is. I keep thinking we're at the bottom, and then there's, you could go way lower. So we'll see what today holds. But each day I learn something new and horrendous that, like, 2 months ago me would not have predicted. So, I mean, it's still, like, thank God we all still have the capacity to remain surprised. Like, I'm surprised and unsurprised. I'm shocked by the audacity. I just would love to wrap up the president and put him on a golf course. Like, for the first time in my life, I'm like, get out there and play golf. Why don't you go golfing for a while and shut the fuck up. Shut your mouth. You are not helping. Please stop talking. Sir, stop talking. Sir. Who's talking?
Is it hard finding a way to do comedy right now? When you were going into this idea of making a show from in quarantine, was it a daunting prospect to be trying to figure out how to be funny in this moment in time?
Yeah, for sure. I mean, daunting in a million different ways, because there's the level of personal anxiety that we feel is at its height. Like, where everybody is frightened, everybody is anxious, people are dying, people are ill, there's so much confusion. There's, in a period of high anxiety, for sure, we may have taken equipment home, but there was no clarity on, like, if we would actually be able to do a show, or if we should actually do a show, or, like, what all of that meant. There was just kind of a kind of instinctive knowledge that we should have our stuff. And then beyond that, there was a period of thinking of, like, we took definitely step down the next show just to kind of assess the situation. And then in that period of great anxiety, it felt to me like a good idea to just have some continuity, to just kind of have that feeling of putting one step in front of the other. And part of that is keeping our job going and doing our work and putting some focus in our lives and our day. And I think it was the right decision, but it certainly was, I really thought deep and hard about it. And doing comedy is like, it's not easy. It's not hard. It's a job. It's a practice. And we've gotten pretty good at making comedy with really hard materials. So this is no exception.
You've had a double digit ratings bump since social distancing began.
Okay.
Is TBS going to make you do the show from your backyard forever and ever?
Well, if what you say is true, then yes. It's possible. I don't know. Nobody said, now you live in the forest. But you know what? It's pretty nice back there. I've got a shed. There's birds fighting. It's going to be green soon. I can't say that I would want to do a show out there in the winter necessarily.
You're Canadian.
But it's I'm a hardy woman. It's not impossible to imagine.
Has there been any silver lining for you or something that's encouraged you in this dark, dark moment?
Actually, I will say this. I did an interview with Katie Porter. And I really like her. But she was very helpful to me in this moment. It's not often that you walk away from an interview going, let me think about, I'm going to ruminate on that. If it's going to give me a 3-day contemplation and it's going to change my whole perspective on this. But one of the things that I asked her was, what do we need to do? Like, what should we all be doing right now? And really her answer was so frank and I needed to hear it. Her answer was basically, and I'm obviously paraphrasing, she was basically like, what we all need to do is live in this reality and really stop thinking about what's going to happen. Like, really stop putting off things that we should be doing now because we don't know how long this is going to last. So she was basically like, if you are having trouble learning how to attend a Zoom meeting or you're having trouble with conference calls, you need to figure that out now. You need to live life as it is in this moment and stop thinking about like, but what if, you know, but in the future, like, when are we going to get back into the studio? Like, when are we all going to be together? When are we going to have an audience? Like, forget about all of that and just be here now for this. If you're having trouble with remote learning, take a moment, sit with it, figure it out, like figure out a plan, make a structure for yourself so that you can live this way for as long as you need to. And if you need to come back to this way of living, that's an easier transition. And I found that reframing very helpful. So I really was living in that kind of headspace of like, well, it's, you know, we're doing this now and then soon enough, or like maybe in May or, you know, who knows? And it was very helpful for me to go, right, you're right. Of course, you're right. This is, I will make a proper setup of lights and where my computer will sit when I do Zoom interviews. And so we did, we made a little permanent, yes, it's a wicker basket, but it's a permanent wicker basket. Okay.
What is one song or book or mantra that's given you comfort recently? Something that's, you know, kind of becoming a part of your life in a way it wasn't 3 weeks ago.
I will say this. I introduced my kids to the music of Dolly Parton and we are so enjoying it. And sometimes we just go for a drive. So there's nowhere to really go. And we just go in the car and we listen to, everyone sings along to 9 to 5 and Islands in the Stream. It's very enjoyable. We really blast it. We were not doing that a month ago. That's a positive, that's a very positive development that my kids are now like, I love this song when Dolly Parton comes on.
I think Dolly Parton can make you even happier in the best of times.
Yeah.
So, yeah. She's, there's something special going on there.
He elevates every moment.
How many rolls of toilet paper do you have right now?
We don't have that much. I gave the children a stern warning last night. We do not have that much. I have a small stash in a drawer. And it, I mean, it's like small. It's like a normal once every 2 weeks stash of toilet paper. I did not panic buy toilet paper at all. So I might like actually put a little sign on the toilet paper.
saying what?
This is valuable resource. Don't know. 2 squares max. 2 squares tops. We will run out. We are very on the verge of running out. There's no toilet paper left anywhere. You can't secure it even if you want to. So it'll be a while to get more.
You've got lots of leaves. Well, not yet, but you will. Just hold on. Hold on till you have some leaves.
Just like a pot holder that you don't care about anymore. A single... Could be doing a lot of hand washing. of old plot holders pretty soon.
I mean, you could use both sides and then.
No, everybody gets their own. We'll cross stitch everybody's name into their own individual plot holder.
Well, on that happy, happy note.
All right.
It's so lovely to talk to you, Samantha. Great to talk to you.
Have a great day.
You too.